53, no rehearsal, living room, no, they never got together. And it's I could talk for the next hour about that, those two tunes. To hear Eleanor King Neary, who I think was an absolute pioneer, matched with another pioneer, I think you get the measure of a genius when they're in the presence of another genius. There's no question in my mind that the two of them are geniuses. Because suddenly the game gets raised. And it's so interesting to hear her matching those ascending and descending ones and triplets. I mean, anyway. All right, I'm gushing, I can't help it. That, by the way, came courtesy of Marty Packy, an accordion player and a wonderful pianist who was on Liz Carroll's first album. He's in Chicago. He's been working very long, well over 10 years, on putting out a definitive collection of Eleanor King Neary's music. And when it happens, we will all be transformed by the idea of what a piano player should be in our social music. Anyway, as you just heard, the genius of Joe Derrane was amply evident then. But it's much more evident since his favorite public comeback, after a hiatus of nearly 35 years, to play an Irish social music on the button accordion at the 18th Annual Irish Folk Festival in Wolfchap, Vienna, Virginia, on May 29, 1994, a pivotal date in his life, a pivotal date in mine as well. He was 64 years of age at the time. During the previous 3 years, Joe Derrane did not play music professionally. He had been retired since 1989 from the Massachusetts Bay Transportation Authority, where he was employed for 27 years, and he was doing part-time data entry for St. Timothy's Roman Catholic Church in Norwood, Massachusetts, when he got an invitation to perform at Wolfchap. His son Joe Jr. and his daughter Sheila, who's here tonight. Sheila, stand up. Sheila. This is Sheila Derrane. Are you? Give her a round of applause. Joe's son Joe Jr. and his daughter Sheila, then in their 30s, had never seen their father perform on the button accordion until May 29, 1994. But Joe Derrane was not vital musically for most of those 35 years. When the Irish dance hall scene began to wane in Boston, and especially Roxbury's Dudley Street area, during the middle to late 1950s, he switched to piano accordion and eventually to electric keyboards in order to keep working as a musician. The money he earned as a musician at night and on weekends was a needed supplement to the money he earned by day at the MBTA. So Joe played jazz, pop, soul, show tunes, Jewish music, and Italian music, often with performers well outside the sphere of Irish music. Joe's own evolving music and style were shaped by that exposure. His musical ideas expanded with his ability. By the time he re-entered the world of Irish traditional music on the button box, he brought with him an emancipated attitude for playing and interpreting music. All the chops he had honed as a wunderkind button accordionist were recovered in time as a sustained hard practice. He used to actually put his hands in a bucket of ice, if I'm not mistaken, because his knuckles were so sore. And then he added to it what he had learned during the 3-day pay interim. And I call it hiatus, the gap in interim. It's hard to get a grip on that. And maybe I'm going to ask some questions about it later on in our Q&A. On November 13, 2010, at the Fairfield Theater Company in Fairfield, Connecticut, I put together a concert for the ages, a tribute concert for Joe Derrane. We had more than 30 musicians and dancers perform in Joe's honor, including fiddler Rose Conway Flanagan, flute and whistle player Marcia Mulvihill, button accordionist Patty Furlong, her step-dancing young daughter Katrina, and pianist Felix Stoll, who also spoke about Joe. Here's a 13-minute film snippet, never before seen in public, of their performance in Felix's words. So the camera work in that video was done by someone who operates a searchlight or prison breaks. So crowded in there. It took me a half an hour to get from the stage to the lobby. It was very nice. And I wanted you to share the characteristics of that snippet. And it wasn't meant to be self-ironized. I forgot that I got this coming from Joe, and I wanted you to see and hear Joe responding to the extraordinary support and praise that he received from his peers. That was crucial, and we had a tremendous amount of music. And you'll see something else from that a little later. had only heard about Joe's comeback at Wolf Trap in 1994. Here's a video sample of what all of us was about. It's Joe Derrane playing an old Walter's 15 square key, two row, D, C sharp button accordion given to him by his friend Jackie Martin. Felix Gullen accompanies on keyboards. They play the reels, Shearing the Sheep, the musical priest. 1,200 people were stuffed in the tent watching him. Terrence Lynch, another accordion player from Washington, turned to me and said, playing off of a Creedence Clearwater Revival hit song, he said, "Bull Stop Derrane." Nobody could, as you'll see. The proof of Joe Derrane's post-combat resurgence during the past 17 years can be heard on the 7 new albums he released during that span. Give Us Another with pianist Felix Dalton in 1995, Return to Inishmore with pianist Carl Hitchin in 1996, The Tide of Vines with six guest musicians in 1998, Ireland's Harvest with fiddler Frankie Gavin and pianist Brian McGraw in 2002, The Boston Edge with Séamus Connolly on fiddle and John McGann on guitar, both of whom are here tonight and perform. That album came out in 2004, The Man Behind the Box with guitarist and mandolinist John McGann in 2006, and Grove Lane with guitarist John McGann in 2010. Throughout, his playing ranges from inventively Irish traditional to inventively exotic that still retains a distinctive Irish flavor or technique, such as in his own compositions, Tango Derrane, Pastiche for Anne, and Caprice. They reflect something he told me in 2004 when he received the U.S. government's highest honor for a traditional musician, the National Heritage Fellowship. Quote, "I feel this award is a validation of the instrument. It's always been my intent to raise the profile of the accordion in and out of Irish music. It's a fantastic instrument capable of far more than most people think. In the last 5 years, I've been exploring the box in a way that I had never done before." To fulfill his own conception of what a button accordion can and should do, Joe Derrane drew a detailed template of the accordion he wanted well-known French luthier Bertrand Bayard to make for him. On his first post-comeback album, Give Us Another in 1995, Joe used the Valdelli and Bartoli 19 key, 4 bass, 2 row, D, C sharp button accordion, similar to the one he used from 1946 to the mid-1950s. On his second post-comeback album, Return to Inishmore in 1996, Joe used a 23 key, 12 bass, 2 row, D, C sharp button accordion, custom made to his specifications by Bertrand Bayard. From his third post-comeback album, The Tide of Vines, 1998, through to his 7th CD, Grove Lane, in 2010, Joe used a 23 key, 14 bass, 2 row, DC sharp button accordion, custom made for specifications by Bertrand Bayard. Armed with precisely the right instrument finally, Joe Derrane made more challenging music that set into relief the fuller capability of his accordion and his own fuller capability of playing it. His use of triplets, 3 consecutive notes, ascending or descending, within the value of a single beat, remains peerless, especially in warm-ups. His harmonics, his chordal structures and substitutions, his changes in key between tunes and a medley, his willingness and uncanny success in taking chances, his maturity and self-awareness that allow him to be what I call a cagey veteran in what he attempts, and his output of 26 new compositions in 17 years, all combined to stamp him as a genius. For example, in his The Humors of Grove Lane hornpipe, which he has not recorded or performed yet, Joe applies American style with more accidentals and tucks in a 2-bar chromatic run that I think even he would agree is hard to play. But music is a platform diving. Degree of difficulty matters in diving. The complexity for its own sake in music loses sight of its objective, to impart individuality without sacrificing or diluting the melody. Joe Derrane plays for, not at, his listeners. This distinction is important in any analysis of musical style. As coveted as it is, virtuosity is simply not enough. As Anthony Tomasini observed in his article, "Virtuosos Becoming a Dime a Dozen," in the August 14, 2011 New York Times, where he discussed many of the young classical pianists, quote, "Technical excellence is such a given that these artists can cultivate real personality, style, and flair," unquote. But Tomasina adds a note of caution, quote, with pianists getting better and better, so many are so good that, paradoxically, I am less impressed by virtuosity, unquote. Joe Derrane has virtuosity beyond measure on the button accordion in Irish traditional music, but he has something else that defines him and distinguishes him from every other box player, a perfect marriage of technical chops with musical passion, integrity, and a desire to please himself while knowing his listeners will be equally pleased. He does not make simple music seem complex. Instead, he makes complex music seem simple. The best insight I can relate to you about the challenge for another button accordion is tackling one of Joe's own compositions comes from Billy McCombson, the 1986 All-Ireland Senior Button Accordion Champion. In preparing for the November 13, 2010 tribute concert I organized with Joe Derrane, Billy phoned me to say he was practicing Hitchner's Séamus, a real Joe wrote and recorded for his album Give Us Another. Quote, this is from Billy. How the hell does he do it? He said over the phone to me. The tune is beautiful and a bitch to learn. It's breaking my knuckles, yet he plays it with no sweat. I never knew how phenomenal a player Joe is until I tried to master that tune of his, unquote. I'll also share a little anecdote. He said, it's just incredibly difficult to deal with. And then he said to me, no wonder he named it after you, Earl. Billy can get away with the slack. In the film sample I'm about to show you from the November 13, 2010 tribute concert to Joe Derrane, Billy McCombson does not play Hitchner's Séamus. But I still want you to see and hear the impact of Billy in an expanded Beaten Fields of America ensemble performing that